I'm grateful to be here with all of you today. And I will speak based on the Ramayana. And I have a PPT which I'll be sharing now. So we'll discuss based on that. So this is our topic, self-acceptance, team spirit, and success. But the Ramayana itself can be understood at various levels. At one level, it's a Leela, where we can just relish whatever is happening in the Leela. At another level, it can also be understood as an ethical play, where we can draw lessons for how to live in our lives. And we will study the Ramayana at that level today. And we see that the Ramayana is very intensely centered on relationships. The relationships of Ram with Dashrath, of Ram with Lakshman, of Ram with Sita, of Ram with Bharat, of Ram with Hanuman. Now, in the Sundar Kand of the Ramayana, Ram is mostly absent. It is the Vanaras who are searching for Krishna, for Sita. And it is at that time that their team spirit is both challenged and manifested. Generally speaking, if there is one authority figure who towers above everyone else, then resolving conflicts and making decisions is relatively easy. But when, now for all the Vanaras, they had Sugriva as their king. Sugriva had just recently become their king. Because Vali had been the king and he had been killed. So the 4 months of Chaturmasya had passed. So in that sense, Sugriva was known to, he was long before when he had been exiled, before he had been exiled, he was known to be a strong warrior. He was the king, and above them, above Sugriva, Sugriva treated Ram very reverentially and they knew Ram's prowess. So now Sugriva and Ram, we could say they are the authorities. In this case, Sugriva was officially the authority and Ram was a powerful prince. Many of them knew that he was God, descended to the earth. So when an authority who towers above everyone else is there, then there is a natural sense of submission. But when that is not there, that is when the team spirit gets challenged a lot. And when the Vanaras went south to search for Sita, at that time, it's interesting that Hanuman was not the team leader of the team that went south. It was Angada who was the team leader. Now, why Angada specifically? Multiple reasons. Now, till now, Hanuman himself had not manifested much of his powers. We know the story where Hanuman had been given phenomenal powers by the gods. He had become very mischievous. And then the sages had cursed him to forget his prowess till he was reminded at appropriate time. So in the intermediate time before he was reminded, Hanuman was still powerful. But he was not extraordinarily powerful. He was one of the powerful Vanara generals. Now moving on. So Hanuman was not appointed at the head. Jambavan was also there. But Angada was the head. Now, Angada was quite young among all the monkeys. And in fact, one of the reasons why Sugriva became the king and not Angada was because Angada was quite young. And of course, Vali also felt that, I had exiled Sugriva, I had persecuted him. So I had to make amends for it. But Angada was royalty. And therefore, he was naturally appointed as the leader of that group. Now, when they came to the south for searching for Sita, they got the information from Sampati that Sita is in Lanka. They were delighted. Till now, they had no clue where she is. And now, at last, they know where she is. And they jubilantly came to the ocean. And then they looked at the giant ocean, which spread as far as the eye could see, and who knew how much further more. And they started thinking, how are we going to cross it? They look at the ocean and they look at each other. They look at the ocean and they look at each other. They look at the ocean, they look at each other. And as the size of the task before them started registering in their minds, their morale started shrinking. We can't do this. Now, you know, if we have any team, we know that the morale of the team matters a lot. So now Angada tried to boost the morale of the monkeys. He said, I'm sure many of you can actually jump across this ocean. Now, Sampati had given them an idea of the dimensions and how far it was, how far they had to jump across. So now they said, they turned to each various monkeys and they said, oh, I can jump this much distance. I can jump this much distance. None of them could actually scale the whole distance. And then Jambavan said, when I was young, I could actually jump across the whole, I could go across the whole earth. Mm-hmm. But now I am old and I don't think I can jump across. Then Angada said that, you know, I can jump across, but it'll exhaust me completely. He said, I'm not sure whether I'll have the strength to leap back again and come. So Jambavan said, actually, you are our prince. You are the leader of our team. You should not go. Jambavan also wanted to help Angada maintain face. Now, in the past, actually, it's not even in the remote past. It's almost till the 19th century. The heads of states would also be warriors. The heads of states were the people who would fight in the war. So even Napoleon, he actually fought in the war himself. The First World War and Second World War, First World War is the time from where, you know, the administrators and the warriors, the fighters, they became separated. There were some wars before that, but especially from that time onwards, it became separated. And now, of course, the soldiers who fight on the war fields, wherever the wars are happening, and the politicians who send them there are completely different. If the politicians once in a while visit the war field also, people think, oh, such a heroic thing the politician has done. So at that time, for the warriors to actually lead from the front was very important. And they couldn't do that, then not only would the whole army's morale go down, but the army's respect for the leader would also go down. So Jambavan was very cautious. He said, no, you should not go. Then Angad became apprehensive and he said, who will go? And that was the time when Jambavan remembered about Hanuman. And then Jambavan started praising Hanuman. And he started praising Hanuman more and more and more. Then what happened? Then he started reminding Hanuman of his celestial birth, his youth, his childhood adventures, how he had got the name Hanuman from his birth name Maruti, and how he had got the various benedictions from the gods, and how he had been cursed. And as he started singing this more and more and more, then Hanuman's size started increasing. His morale started increasing internally and his size started increasing externally. So this was the time when Hanuman remembered the Hanuman that Hanuman had forgotten. There was a Hanuman who was there right now, but his prowess he had forgotten. So it was a curious case of selective amnesia, we could say. So, you know, sometimes when parents, when the child is very mischievous or undisciplined in some way, the parents may ground the child. Ground the child means, okay, you know, you cannot go out with your friends, you cannot watch TV, you cannot do this. So certain facilities are taken away, and that's the way the child is disciplined. So now for Hanuman, what could they do? Now, he was mischievous. But the mischief was, he was not hanging, the mischief was not because he was hanging out with other monkeys. The mischief was because he had some powers. So they used selective amnesia to make him forget his powers. And then, at that time, when the powers were needed, at that time, Jambavan spoke, and then the power started manifesting. And then Hanuman said, I will leap across the ocean. And I can, at this moment, he was so confident, so jubilant, because he also felt burdened. At that time, when all the monkeys were saying, how much can they jump? Hanuman was silent and pensive. Something within him was calling him forward. At the same time, there was something within him which was hesitating. At a conscious level, he thought, I can't do this. I don't have the prowess. But at a deeper level somewhere, I can do this. So he was caught in this dilemma, and that's why he was pensive. So even when people have amnesia, it's not that they forget completely. They forget, but there are times when certain echoes from the past come to them. So he was in that situation. He hadn't spoken at all. But when Jambavan started speaking, so he realized, yes, we are not going to be defeated. We can be successful. He started jubilantly proclaiming. He said, what do you want me to do? I can go there and I will uproot the whole Lanka and bring it back. I will arrest Ravan and bring him back. I can bring Sita back right now with me. So I can destroy Lanka if you want. What do you want? So Angad said, no, we are messengers. So just let us do what we have been told to do. And said, please, you go and give Ram's message to Sita and get to know about her whereabouts and her well-being, and then come back. And then Hanuman flew into the sky. How significantly, when Hanuman flew into the sky, all the monkeys were watching him with joyous eyes and eager hearts. And then they told Hanuman, as he was flying into the sky, we will pray for your success. And not only will we pray for your success, he said, we will perform austerities for your success. And what are the austerity? They said that we will stand on one foot and perform yogic meditation and offer the fruits of our austerity to you. So although Hanuman was in the lead, that didn't mean that all the monkeys, remaining monkeys, are just sitting and relaxing. They performed austerities. Now, in general, if we compare with the sports, in sport, there are some which are individual sports like tennis or boxing, and there are team sports like football, baseball, cricket. Now, if you consider cricket, the team that is batting, maybe two batsmen are out there and the remaining batsmen are in the pavilion. Now, although they're in the pavilion, in spirit, they are there. They're all watching the match and they're off. They may not be praying, but still they're offering their best wishes. They're eagerly and they're involved over there. So generally, a team is, there are individuals in the team, but there is also a team spirit which unites everyone. And that unity, that is extremely important. So this is the background. It is this incident based on which we'll be discussing today's talk. So we'll be mentioning three distinct points. What is team spirit and why it matters? Then why self-acceptance matters? And then how to increase our self-acceptance. As we discussed, the monkeys could not cross, yet they found and encouraged the one who could cross. Often teams are sabotaged by one-upsmanship, where if one person wants to be the number one, and if they can't be the number one, then they push everyone else down. They say, no, if I can't be the number one, nobody else should be. But that was not the spirit of the monkeys. So generally, if the team spirit is there, then the idea is that the team should win even if I am not the star performer. So there are times when a particular person, a particular member of the team becomes a star performer. So if you consider cricket, sometimes it might be the opening batsman. Sometimes it might be the middle order batsman. Sometimes it might be even a tail ender who does something heroic. So in bowling, sometimes it's the spin bowler. Sometimes it's the fast bowler. Sometimes it's a part-time bowler. So whoever it is, there's a saying in English, every dog has his day. That means different people at different times, they may perform. So the idea is that, okay, whoever is performing, that's great. I will support that performer and the team should win. That is team spirit. Now, on the other hand, self-seeking spirit is where I want to be the star performer even if my team fails. So, say this might happen in cricket where somebody is, now I want to get to my century, but to get my century, I'll plan very slowly. And in the process, if the team loses also, I got my record. Now, this is very damaging to the morale of the team. When, naturally, within a team also, players want to be achievers. That is just a human tendency. We all want to achieve things. But at the same time, there is the collective achievement that is important. So, if the players start playing for themselves, then the team suffers. So, broadly, we could say that the attitude of individuals in the team can go to two extremes. That if I am the star, then I will do my best. That's one extreme. And if I am not the star, then why should anyone else be? I will not let anyone else be the star also. I will not let anyone else be the star. So, that could mean at a, say, if we consider a sports like cricket, that could mean that if a batsman has a record and another batsman is about to go exceed that record, this batsman may deliberately make that batsman run out. So, I will sabotage the other person. But that would be very unhealthy. And the healthy attitude is that I will do my best to help my team do the best. And when I say I will do my best means sometimes I may play the star role. Sometimes I may play the supporting role. So whatever role I have to play, I will play to the best of my capacity. It's significant that from in that team hierarchy, Angad was the team leader. That's from the like the official hierarchy point of view. From the team hierarchy, Jambavan was the senior most. But neither of them claimed credit based on that. Neither of them said, you know, we have to go. They admitted their inability. And we can have many different definitions of humility. One simple definition of humility is the ability to admit our inability. The ability to admit our inability when something is beyond us. Sometimes there is the idea that there, wherever there is a hierarchy, hierarchies are very bad and they're very exploitative. So somebody's at the top and they will dominate everybody who's at the bottom. Well, yes, it can happen at times, but there are many places where hierarchies are legitimate and essential. Say, for example, parent-child. The parents love their children. At the same time, they have to guide their children. So, for functioning in any team setting, some kind of hierarchy is required. And yes, there are situations when those at the top can dominate others. But there are many other situations where those at the top also want to help others. You know, people who are successful, one of the generally, when people are very young, maybe 20, 25, 30, 35, 40, till that time, the whole passion is, I want to get to the top. And once when somebody achieves a reasonable amount of success, one of the joys in people's lives is to help others rise. And that gives them great fulfillment. That not only did I rise, but I helped others to rise. So Jambavan, he had his day earlier when he had flown across the ocean. Jambavan had his day many times before. But now, it gave him great joy to help Hanuman remember. So now, Angad was basically too young to remember the time when Hanuman was that powerful. And we talk about all the Vanaras as one team, but not all the Vanaras lived at the same place. They all lived in different parts of the world. And they had to be called by Sugriv, and that's why things were delayed for some time. So, if Jambavan had conveniently said, if Jambavan would have remembered, what he said, no, Hanuman will get all the glory. Why should he get the glory? He could have said, I don't remember. He needn't have said that. Actually, Hanuman is so powerful. He didn't have to remind Hanuman of that. But what was his spirit? We as a team have to succeed. So I will do my best to help my team succeed. That is team spirit. So sometimes some people are just good at certain things. And if they are good at those things, we need to help them do those good things where they excel. So we could say now, apart from the pendulum, we could also have a four quadrant interaction between individual performance and team performance. Now, if you go here to the left bottom, neither the individual performs well nor the team performs well, then that would be a debacle. It is just no. It's an embarrassing failure. Now, if a particular individual is not performing well, but the team is performing well, when will that happen? When one player, say, covers, compensates for the other player. Hey, you are not doing so well today. Then others take the responsibility. So then what happens is, then okay, if one player doesn't, then the team can still perform even if particular individuals are not able to perform. In India in the 1990s, probably, maybe later also, little before, little later, Sachin Tendulkar was like the star of the team. And most people, when they would watch the match, if Tendulkar gets out, they would just switch off the TV. So because it's over now. So there are not many supporting players that great. So what happens, it's just become, the team is there, but it's one person. But when there are many players, okay, if everybody sometimes has an off day, somebody else takes over. Somebody else supports. So that's mutual compensation. Now, that is good. Now, the opposite of that would be competition. There can be healthy competition, and there can be what is called internecine competition. Internecine means I pull you down and you pull me down. It's mutually damaging. It's mutually destructive. So there can be politics. There can be backbiting. There can be every sort of way in which the mind can conceive by which people are pulled down. Now, when this happens, so the individuals may excel, but the team doesn't excel so well because the individuals are pulling each other down. So now at one level, we could say this is just ego and this is arrogance and we should not have ego. We'll discuss about that. Why it might happen in this level where the team, the members excel, but the team doesn't excel. But this is unhealthy. So we could say both at the bottom level where the team is not performing, that is unhealthy. Just the individual performing is not good enough. Now, of course, an individual may perform and the team may not perform. That's possible at some levels. But when it is, the individual is performing at the cost of the team performance, then that is unhealthy. So then this best is where there is synergy, where the individual is also performing very well and the team is also performing very well. So now we are, whatever it is, we might be as a family, we are a team. In our profession, we might be a team. In our temple, we are doing services where we might be a team. So we work at and teams at various levels. And some teams are more organic, which are formed based on just people like-minded. And some teams are more organizational. That means because of an organizational necessity, some people come together. So now, often the challenge is, if the teams are organic, then people naturally have an understanding of each other and it's easier to work. But if the team is organizational, because of organizational goals, certain people are brought together, then the challenges can be significant. So with these two diagrams of the pendulum and the four quadrant, now let's look at that. So we discussed why team spirit matters. Now the next part we'll discuss is why self-acceptance matters. So self-acceptance means that, as I said earlier, sometimes we may not have the ability to do certain thing. So we have to admit our inability. Sometimes if the self-acceptance is not there, then there will be self-sabotage. Self-sabotage and team sabotage will be there. So if somebody seeks a lead role, even if we don't have the ability to lead, then we suffer and the team suffers. See, if one of the Vanaras had said, yes, I can go to Lanka, and all the other Vanaras had been waiting, and this Vanara leaps across and maybe falls into the ocean and dies, or maybe reaches there and is so exhausted that it can't penetrate into Lanka, or is caught by the demons over there. Now, other monkeys would not even come know what is happening. So, at one level, we all want to do our best. So a physical inability is not a character deficiency. All the Vanaras were devoted to Lord Ram. But just because they were devoted, that didn't necessarily make them equally physically empowered. I will talk a little bit later about the concept of empowerment. But at this stage, this is an important point. Does that mean that because they were not empowered, is that a character deficiency? No, it's not a character deficiency. Is it that they were deficient in devotion? Well, yes, Hanuman's devotion was extraordinary. But that doesn't necessarily have to imply that other monkeys were deficient in their devotion. They all had a genuine desire to serve the Lord. And the Lord had a plan. So the Lord chose a particular person. So, in general, see, there is a physical inability, and there is a moral deficiency. So, or as in our context, it's a devotional deficiency. So, to equate a physical inability with moral deficiency, that is being judgmental. And when any society or any group starts doing that, and it is on the path to ruin, it is in the path to ruination. So, for example, much of American Christianity follows the idea of what is called as prosperity gospel. Prosperity gospel or prosperity theology means that my prosperity is the proof of my piety. In fact, that was the ideology to some extent that led to the whole colonization of the world several hundred years ago also. Now, the term prosperity theology might not have been there at that time. But the idea is that it is by God's grace that the European countries thought that we have become so powerful. And it is our sacred duty to God to spread what they thought was enlightenment across the world. So they equated poverty with lack of God's grace. So similarly, now that is basically in our tradition's language, karma kanda. So we may condemn karma kanda, but we may actually subscribe to a subtle version of that, where we think that if, say, a particular devotee does a particular service very well, if a particular devotee stalks, get lots of views, that means this devotee is empowered. If a particular devotee is able to distribute a lot of books, then this devotee is empowered. If a particular devotee is able to raise a lot of funds, then this devotee is empowered. Yes, it could be that they are empowered. It could also be that they have the material skills necessary for that, and others do not. It could be that there's a combination of both. So we don't have to become judgmental. In general, if some devotee is doing a service very well, we appreciate. We don't minimize that devotee. This is just your material ability you're doing it. Because how do we know that? It could be that they have the material ability, but they also have the sincerity of the heart. So if a devotee is doing service well, we appreciate that devotee and we don't have to deconstruct that success too much. But the opposite is important not to do. That if a particular devotee is not able to do any service so well, that does not mean that it's a devotional deficiency. It simply means that, yes, Krishna has different devotees playing different roles in his plan. And some devotees may not be materially empowered to do particular services. So none of the Vanaras chose to take up a service which they knew they could not do. So that was, if there's no self-acceptance, then that problem comes up. So now when we accept our inabilities, what happens? Broadly, there are two possibilities. One is that if we accept it, then there is redirection of efforts. Okay, this is what I should do. And maybe, so as the Vanaras, they decided, okay, we can't fight, but we will wait back. We will wait and we will choose to bide our time. On the other hand, if they don't do that, there'll be defeat. So now here we see Vali and Sugriva fighting. That's a different context entirely. But the principle there was that Vali had a huge amount of arrogance. And because of arrogance, he presumed that he knew Sugriva's motives. And that's why he banished Sugriva and he persecuted Sugriva. And deep within his heart, he thought, maybe I'm wrong. You know, maybe Sugriva will not do like this. But he suppressed that. So he could not accept that maybe his judgment was wrong. And because he didn't accept his judgment was wrong, the two of them had been an undefeatable team. But here what happened was, they came to a situation where they had to fight against each other. So sometimes we need to accept our inabilities, that maybe we can't do something, maybe we don't even know something properly. Okay. Now here we consider the idea of self-worth. So now self-acceptance is very much related with self-worth. In modern times, self-worth or self-esteem is considered very important. Now, where might we get our self-worth from? It might come from the size of our contribution as compared to others. That, oh, you know, this person did this much, I did this much. And therefore, I'm great. And then another source of it could be size of our contribution as compared to our capacity. Okay, this is what I could do and this is what I have done. So the first one, size of our contribution as compared to others, in the real world, at a functional level, that kind of comparison has to happen. If a particular person can do a particular task well, then they will naturally, it's better to give them that task. The whole team will flourish. So that is at a functional level. We should not have a competitive mentality. That is true. But what do we mean by that term competitive mentality? We live in a competitive society and we will be rated, whether it is in the professional world or whether it is in the relational world, when people form relationships. When anybody wants to form a particular relationship, they actually assess, is this person appropriate for me? When they assess, what are they doing? They're actually evaluating. So we cannot avoid that kind of evaluation at a functional level. But different from a functional assessment is one's self-worth. If our self-worth comes from, say, how much am I doing as compared to someone else? See, at least how much am I doing is one thing. It would be another thing is how much am I getting? So for many people, their self-worth becomes reduced to their net worth. And if they find that somebody is earning more than them, they feel, what am I doing with my life? Yes, money is important. But we can't let money define our self-worth. So size of our contribution as compared to our capacity means, okay, this is what I can do and this is what I did. This is what I did yesterday and this is what I'm doing today. So I am on the path of growth. So from where our self-worth comes is very important. So without a healthy source of self-worth, we will always be in a state of insecurity. And in that insecurity will make us even unconsciously do things that sabotage the team. In India, the top universities are the IITs. In America, they are the Ivy Leagues. So there have been a significant number of studies about the students who go to these universities and they graduate from them. So now these students who can even get into these universities are phenomenally brilliant. And so there's no doubting their IQ and their brilliance. But from a psychological perspective, it is found that many of these students, they suffer from emotional turbulence. That means whenever they meet someone, if they find I'm smarter than them, that person, I feel superior. I feel good about myself. And as soon as they find, oh, this person is smarter than me, they start feeling inferior. They start feeling insecure because of that. So here, in a sense, every one of them is brilliant, but then they are pitted against other brilliant students. So what happens is, unless they have intrinsic self-worth, it becomes very difficult to maintain security, maintain stability. So with respect to competitions, it's said often, I say if there are three prizes, there is a gold medal, a silver medal, and the bronze medal. So what happens? The gold medalist and the bronze medalist, both are happy. The silver medalist is miserable. Now, why is that? Because the gold medalist, I got the top. The bronze medalist, at least I got something. But for the bronze medalist, it is a comparing, oh, I could have got the gold and I didn't get the gold. So in general, if we cannot avoid comparing, but if we let that comparison become the basis of our self-worth, then it will be a problem. So each of the Vanaras, they knew that they had a role, they had a service, and they focused on doing their service. So now each Vanara, he got his day. Like I said, every dog has his day. So Angada, he had his day later. Here, Hanuman had gone as a messenger. Just before the war, Angad went as a messenger the previous evening, and he gave a warning. And when Ravan said, you know, your army is insignificant, we'll crush you on the first day itself. So Angad issued a challenge. He said that, you know, I will plant my leg in front of you. Let any of your monkey, any of your demon Rakshasa generals, just come and move my foot. And all the demons came and they were so enraged at this challenge. They thought, we will just not only move his foot, we'll knock him down and we'll smash him to death for challenging us like this. But they came and they couldn't even budge his foot one bit. And finally, Ravan himself got up and Ravan came there. And when Ravan bent down, Angad knocked off Ravan's crown and he moved away. And he said, oh fool, if you want to touch anyone's feet, touch Ram's feet. He will save you. My challenge was for your generals, not for you. And then his fingers, he flew away. But he got that day right in the court of Ravan. He was able to display his promise. So everybody will get their day. It may not be as glorious as somebody else's, but there'll be time when we can do service. Jambavan, he had his time. There are many warriors he killed during the war. There were, as I said, before that, he had circumnavigated the earth. He had done extraordinary services during his time. So self-acceptance comes when our self-worth, we have intrinsic self-worth. Now, if we don't have that intrinsic self-worth, then how do we go about increasing our self-acceptance? That will be the remaining and the last part of the talk. So I'll talk about this self-acceptance. We don't live in isolation. So we live in a community. So our self-acceptance depends not only on us, it also depends on others. And this is where the team leader's role comes in. The team leader at one level will naturally appreciate somebody who does some extraordinary service. But it's important for the team leader to also value every member in the team. So Lord Ram was like a team leader like that. Now he appreciated the monkeys who were carrying giant boulders when they had to jump across, when they had to build the bridge across the ocean. At the same time, you see there a squirrel carrying a small pebble. And Lord Ram appreciated the squirrel also. So the idea is that in a team, there'll be different people, and all different people will make different capacity contributions according to different capacities. And naturally, somebody who is a star, they will get greater credit. When Hanuman came back after his victorious mission, Lord Ram embraced him. In fact, the commentators on the Ramayana say that at that time, when Hanuman described how he had jumped across the ocean, how he had met Sita, how he had warned Ravan, how he had set Lanka on fire, and how he had done all this single-handedly, achieving stupendous success, Ram was so delighted. Ram said, I want to offer you something. He said, but what can I offer you? I don't have anything. I'm a pauper. I'm an exilee. He says, I will offer you my body itself. And he said, and he offered him his embrace. And Hanuman felt fully enriched by that embrace. So Lord Ram did give special recognition to those who were the star performers. In this case, Hanuman. But that doesn't mean he neglected. When others were telling the squirrel, get out of the way, you're just coming in our way. Ram said, no. The squirrel is serving according to her capacity. And I appreciate that. So one side is the team leader's role. For individuals to have self-acceptance, everybody needs to be valued. The particular appreciation might be proportionate to the contribution, but the basic valuing every person for being there, that is important. Suppose we go to a temple. Now, we might just be one among 100 people or 500 people, but the very least we may expect is that somebody greets us, smiles at us, few people just nod at us. We may not accept a special kind of recognition, but at least there has to be a human connection that is there. So that is the team leader's role from that perspective. So appreciate special contributors and appreciate everyone's contribution, whatever it is. That can be proportionate. So now, but now let's move on to self-acceptance at an individual level. How can we go about doing that? So there are broadly two trajectories we might follow. One is if we are not able to accept our limitations. Now, self-acceptance, if we already have some good qualities, if we have some special abilities, there's no struggle in accepting that. I want more of that and I want the whole world to know I have that. When we talk about self-acceptance, it is not so much about either our virtues or about abilities. It is about our inabilities usually. So what do we do at that time? If we are not able to accept our limitations, then we go downward. There is resentment. Why can't I do this? And then there is envy. Why can this person do it? And then essentially what happens is that combination of resentment and envy, it destroys us. It leads us to the path of self-destruction. And unfortunately, in today's world, both of these are very much possible, increasingly possible, because we live in very hugely interconnected worlds. So our whole frame of reference can become huge. And because it becomes so big, it becomes very difficult for people to actually deal with the situation. Say, I think last year I was at a mental health and spirituality conference. So I presented from Bhagavita's perspective. This was in America. And now one of the participants was explaining how there are mental health problems for everyone. But recently, maybe in the last 20 years, since social media has come up, mental health problems in terms of depression and low self-esteem have increased phenomenally, especially among teenage girls. Now, why is the reason for this? There could be many reasons, but one reason is that there is excessive amount of comparison. So what happens is if somebody looks at one's own figure and somebody looks at the figures of how attractive somebody else looks. Now, whenever people put photos, whether it is some famous models or even ordinary people, when they put the photos generally on Facebook, people always put their happiest moments there. And when we compare our real life with what are often doctored images of people's happiness, that is why it's never good enough for me. So, yeah. Then what happens is that sort of comparison, it leads to resentment, it leads to envy, and it leads to depression. So, actually, rather than spending too much time on Facebook, of course, we can use Facebook for constructive purposes, like say, now we might be doing when we are having Facebook streaming, but in general, it needs to be regulated. It said that those who can't face books end up on Facebook. Face books. That means, you know, we have books like the Bhagavatam, the Bhagavad Gita, the Ramayana. We read them, we relish them. And then there we will get a healthy sense of self-worth because we will understand we are all parts of the Lord. So So what kind of sources we are exposing ourselves to will also determine whether we are able to accept ourselves or not. So if we don't accept our limitations, if we don't accept, then we go on this downward trajectory. If we accept our limitations, then we move upward. There is self-acceptance, and then there is self-actualization. Actualization means whatever is our potential, we'll be able to develop that. So we'll discuss how we can go on this trajectory towards self-actualization. But before that, let's look at what do we mean by accepting our limitations. Now, sometimes it may be even difficult to perceive our limitations. If there are physical abilities, say if somebody tells you, can you lift up this 50 kg weight? Well, 50 kg, maybe it's better if you have one more person. So we might say that if something is physically measurable, it's relatively easier to perceive. But when something is subtler, it's a little bit more intangible. And then it becomes a little more difficult to perceive. So sometimes we may not only have limitations, but we may have limitations in perceiving our limitations. So many of you may have heard of that four-level trajectory. There is unconscious competence, there's conscious competence, there is conscious incompetence, and there's unconscious incompetence. That means some children, they are musical prodigies. This at the age of 3-4, they pick up kartal, they pick up mridang, and they start playing it phenomenally well. They don't even know how they are doing it. Nobody taught them really much. They just maybe pick it up from a previous life. So that is almost unconscious competence. Some people is conscious competence. You know, they have to strive and then they get it right. Some people strive, but they just can't get it right. But sometimes if a kirtan is going on in the temple and somebody just picks up a kartal and starts banging, and some of them have closed their eyes and they are in bliss, and everybody around them is agony. They are at the level of unconscious incompetence. They are playing the kartal wrong. They're just banging it, but they are thinking they are contributing to the music, but they're actually detracting from the music. So with respect to subtler abilities, sometimes it's difficult to perceive. That's why even perception requires some maturity, some consultation. So that's one limitation. But beyond that, once we have perceived a limitation, so by our own self-observation, by consulting with others, by prayer, then now there are some limitations which we can break and which can extend, and some limitations which we cannot break. So in today's world, often the idea is there that the sky is the limit. You can do whatever you want. Well, yes and no. There are limitations that we can push beyond, and there are some limitations which we can't push beyond. So rather than thinking we can do anything, let's find out what we are good at and then focus on that. So looking inward before looking outward is much more helpful than looking outward and then looking inward and finding that we are deficient. What that means is we look outward and see what is glamorized in the world. So, okay, sports players are glamorized, so I want to become a sports player. Movie stars are glamorized, I want to become a movie star. Or say, software engineers are glamorized, I want to become a software engineer. Okay, that's one way of looking at it. Another way is, okay, as we grow up, we observe ourselves, we help our children observe ourselves. Even when we are growing in our career, we observe ourselves, look inward, and then look outward. Okay, this is what I am good at, how can I contribute? So somebody who doesn't have a musical bone in their body, and that means they are practically tone deaf. No matter how much they practice, they are not going to become a Mozart. That is, so there are some limitations which are unbreakable. So say, if somebody can lift a weight of a particular capacity, that doesn't mean that they can lift a weight of any capacity. So if somebody can lift 25 kg weight and they suddenly pick up 100 kg weight, then they will get crushed under it. So we know about this. Comfort zone, stretch zone, and panic zone. So we all need to push ourselves. But some limitations are such that if we try to push ourselves, we'll be overwhelmed. That will take us into panic zone. So, okay, these are some things which maybe this is a project which I'll postpone to my next lifetime. I can't work on this right now. We all have to choose our battles. And there are other areas where we can work. So then what do? We focus on those areas and take steps forward. So certain limitations we can push. So I'm talking here about self-actualization, self-acceptance to self-actualization. That's the journey we're talking about. So for that purpose, we need to recognize, okay, these limitations I can't push, so let me accept it. These limitations I can push, so let me push them. So we don't want to live we don't want to live in our comfort zone for the rest of our life in the name of self-acceptance. Self-acceptance means this is where I am at and this is where I want to go. See, one of the easiest, of course, it's not easy for us. It is not easy on us, but it is easy for us. What do I mean by that? One of the easiest ways to make our life miserable is to make everything important. As soon as we make everything important, we make ourselves important. Why? Because it just becomes too much. How can I process all this? Of course, everything needs to be given due attention, but we also need to prioritize. Okay, this is the most important thing for me. The second most important thing is the third most important thing. So we have to choose our battles. Okay, I want to improve, but if somebody says, I'll give you some feedback. And okay, yeah, I would like to improve. And somebody suddenly tells you, tell the 35 things you want to improve. You need to improve. That becomes, you know, a 30, maybe somebody has a list of 300 goals. Well, that's not a goal. That's a wish list. Okay, it's good to have wish lists, but shorten it down. Choose your battles. So we decide, this is the area I want to improve on. And then we come out of our comfort zone and we move onwards. So there may be many things which may be important, but what is important right now for me? This is what I will focus on. So that way we can improve ourselves materially in terms of abilities. But apart from improving our abilities, there is another definition. We need to also go inside and redefine ourselves, redefine our idea of greatness rather. So usually in society, somebody who overcomes a huge amount of obstacles and succeeds, they are considered to be great. And yes, that's one that I bend life to my will. I got life to say yes. Sometimes some people are glorified as saying they never took no for an answer. Well, that might be good sound to sound in to praise someone, but that's not a reality for anyone. You know, everybody has to take no's in certain areas so that they can focus and get yes in some areas. So actually, it requires a certain amount of greatness in the sense that one has to have a great strength of character to accept a no. Yeah, I can't do this. So getting life to say yes to us is one measure of greatness, but accepting when life says no to us, that is also greatness. Okay, this is not meant to be. It's fine. Now, I might seem to give a lot of examples from cricket, but that's probably a sport which many of us may be familiar with. And probably you can think of examples from other sports. Now in India, Sachin Tendulkar is considered to be the god of cricket. In the early days of his life, he actually also wanted to be a medium pace bowler. And then he had gone to a bowling coaching academy. And then the top bowler, Australian bowler, told him, you know, you are a good batsman. You focus on that. And he could bowl, but he was more of a part-time bowler. So he invested all his energies after that on batting and he became a batting legend. So, but one part of that was, okay, maybe as a bowler, I'm not meant to be. So that also requires a certain amount of willingness that, okay, this is not going to be, this can be. So if we start thinking, that's why I said, if we make everything important, we make ourselves important. Yes, this is not necessarily for me to do. Somebody else will do this. That is what I can do. So we need to actually reconceptualize greatness. Accepting no gracefully is also a sign of greatness. In fact, more often than not, how a person accepts reversals or failures gracefully, that will determine their destiny much more then how they get life to say yes to them. Because relatively speaking, in our lives, we will usually have to take many more no's than we can get yeses in life. And if no's devastate us, if we can't accept them, that will be a big problem. So that brings us, now this is where spiritual wisdom can help us. That if we have philosophical understanding based on bhakti wisdom, then when we encounter our limitations, we won't become resentful. No, why can't I do this? Rather, we'll become thoughtful. What do I mean by thoughtful here? Broadly, there are four stages, and we will conclude with this. That when we have to gain self-acceptance, first is we break free from the ego's constraints. What do I mean by the ego's constraints? So the ego defines us in a particular way. And by defining us in a particular way, the ego deprives us of who we actually are or who we can be. This is what you have to be. And if you can't do this, that's a disaster. I can't accept it. So when we often think about give up your ego, we think of in terms of, you know, don't seek so much honor. And often giving up ego is seen in a sense of deprivation. Oh, I should not seek honor. I should not seek pride. Actually, we need to reconceptualize the ego also. The ego doesn't deprive us of honor. Actually, the ego deprives us of who we are. The ego makes us believe and labor to be someone who we are not. And in that process, it deprives us of who we are. So when we talk about renunciation of either physical possessions or of even our conceptions, it is, you know, we want to give up things so that we can be who we are meant to be. We can fulfill our potential. So to break free from the ego's constraints, we understand who we are. We are not our abilities. We are souls who are parts of Krishna, and we have been given certain abilities. So I have been given certain abilities. Somebody else has been given certain abilities. So understanding who we are doesn't end with the soul. We appreciate whose we are. That means we are parts of Krishna. We are parts of an all-attractive supreme. And then we recognize what gives ultimate fulfillment. That is reconnecting with Krishna. We might do wonderful services in the world, but if that makes us crave more and more for praise from the world, then that is not going to give us fulfillment. Because we get praise and we'll want more praise. And we'll want more praise. Even if we do wonderful services, the purpose of those services is to connect us with Krishna. And that is what will give us fulfillment. So, now each of these could be elaborated more, but I'll not go into all of them. So what happens is, as I said, ego, it deprives us of the privilege of who we are. And it makes us believe we are something we aren't. Oh, I am this person who can do all these things. Well, if you can't do those things, don't put a burden on yourself and put a burden on others. No, even if you can't do those things, still you are a worthwhile person. You are a part of Krishna. You are such a precious part of Krishna that Krishna is personally present in your heart. So we need to let go of the ego, and actually we will let ourselves free of a big burden. So our real identity is that we are parts of the Lord. And then this is a key point, that the material ego makes us believe that I will become satisfied if I get a bigger part. But the reality is, we don't need a bigger part to become satisfied. We need to do our part better. If we just do our part better, we'll be satisfied. Say, if we are attending a class, we may feel, oh, why don't I get an opportunity to give a class? I want to give a class. Well, we may also get opportunities in future. But our satisfaction will come not by whether I have the leading part of giving a class or I have the part of attending the class. Whichever part I have, how well am I doing that part? If I'm absorbing myself in Krishna, then I'll be enriched. I'll be spiritually satisfied. Maya can be sometimes so subtle that sometimes by hearing a class, or whenever a class occurs, Sometimes the audience, by hearing the class, can make more spiritual advancement than the speaker can make by giving the class. Although the speaker is much more active, much more in prominence. But if the speaker is thinking, oh, how many people are going to praise me for my class? And the audience is thinking, oh, I'm getting an opportunity to remember Krishna. Let me immerse myself in this remembrance. So then actually the audience will grow more spiritually. So satisfaction depends on doing our part better, not necessarily on getting a bigger part. So that's why I talked earlier about redefining success for us. One aspect of redefining success is that I accept taking no, but another aspect is also redefining that I don't need a bigger part to be happy in my life. If Krishna gives me a bigger part, that's great. But if I don't, even with the part I have, I can be happy. And then this is what brings in that for us often, but I want to do something big for Krishna. Well, that's fine. But the size of our service is not as important as our service attitude. What will enable us to do something, what will enable us to grow in our spiritual life is not just the specific service that we do, but the overall service attitude that we have. Quite often, we sometimes may feel disheartened even in our bhakti. Why? Because we want to do something wonderful for Krishna and we are unable to do it. And that principle applies in general life also. Everybody wants to do something wonderful in their profession, in their family, whatever situation they are in. And many times we get depressed, disheartened when we are not able to do something wonderful. Now, one of the ways to get out of depression is said to be just do something for someone else. Somebody is a very depressed person. You know, maybe go to an underprivileged area and give some food to some poor people. Do something for someone. What happens by that is get out of yourself. You see that you can do something worthwhile. You can help somebody in some small way. So there are two things: doing something wonderful and doing something worthwhile. We often find that we are unable to do something wonderful and we become disheartened by that. However, even if we can't do something wonderful, we can always do something worthwhile. And our fulfillment, our spiritual growth doesn't depend on our ability to do something wonderful. It depends on our willingness to do something worthwhile. And bhakti offers us the opportunity to do something worthwhile at every moment. Just, you know, we just talk about Krishna with someone. Maybe that can change their life. It's worthwhile. Even if it doesn't change their life, we are remembering Krishna at that time and we are growing by that. So, every moment we have the opportunity to do something worthwhile. So, if we focus on, not so much whether I can do something wonderful or not, but can I do something worthwhile or not? And if we can focus that way, we'll find that we can move ahead at every moment in our life. And that is the essence of service attitude. Can I do something worthwhile? Now, if Krishna wants, he may empower me and what I'm doing may grow from being worthwhile to even being wonderful. But even if it doesn't become wonderful, let it at least be worthwhile. That's how we can grow. So this is how self-acceptance works. This is the concluding slide. That sometimes self-acceptance can improve our material ability also. Okay, this is what I can't work on, but this is what I can work on. This is what I'll work on. Like I talked about going beyond the comfort zone. This area I can't work, this area I can work. And so if we can improve our material ability and we can improve materially also, we can become a better person, more capable, more competent. That is one way to self-actualization. But another way self-acceptance can lead to self-actualization is we improve our spirituality. Improve our spirituality means we, as I said, we understand whose we are. We understand what really gives fulfillment. And rather than seeking a bigger part, we focus on doing our part better. And by that, whatever roles we have been assigned, we have been allotted by the Lord's plan, we will find fulfillment therein. And that's how, as we move from self-acceptance towards self-actualization, you know, whatever team we are part of, whatever role we are there in the team, we can be fulfilled and we can synergistically contribute to the team. And that's what the Vanaras did. And that's what we also can learn from them. So I'll summarize. what I spoke today. I spoke on the topic of team spirit, self-acceptance, team spirit, and success. So it started by talking about how the Vanaras were stymied at the ocean, and then they all encouraged and aided Hanuman to go ahead. And Jambavan reminded Hanuman of his prowess, and then Hanuman leapt across. So they had the team spirit. Even if I can't do it, let Hanuman do it. So we discussed that the pendulum, that the attitude of a team members may be, if I can be the star, then I will do my best. Or if I can't be the star, why should anyone do the best? So that will, that is unhealthy. The idea is, I will do my best so that the team can do the best. And sometimes I may have the star role, sometimes I may have the supporting role. Then there's the four quadrant diagram that, you know, if neither the team nor the individuals perform, it will be a debacle. If some individuals don't perform, but the team still performs, how does that happen? When one player compensates for the other player. The individuals are performing, but the team is not performing well. That's often because the team members are working at cross purposes against each other. It's internecine competition. And best is where the team members perform and the individual and the team also perform. That's synergistic. So we are social beings, and that's why we need to have team spirit, whatever team we are playing in, are part of. So now, to develop team spirit, we need to develop self-acceptance. And the second, in self-acceptance, I talked about, what does it mean? That it means humility is the ability to accept our inabilities. And if self-acceptance is not there, then there is resentment and envy. And then that leads to self-destruction. So for self-acceptance to be there, at one level, there's a team leader's role, that the team leader's, if team leader's role is that, team leader appreciate everyone. And at another level, the individual's role is twofold. That we do honest self-observation and understand, okay, this is not what I'm good at, this is what I'm good at. And accept our inability. Sometimes it may require us to assess carefully, because some abilities are subtler and not so easily measurable. And then we redirect. So greatness is not just in getting life to say yes, but also accepting when life says no. So then when there is self-acceptance, okay, this is not meant to be, but I can go in this area. It's redirection of efforts. And we all can work. There are certain areas, certain limitations can't be pushed. Pushing them makes us panicky. But there are certain limitations which can and should be pushed. And that gets us out of the comfort zone. And even at a material level, we can improve our abilities that way. And the other is that we reconceptualize what really matters for us. So we understand that we are spiritual beings. So our ego wants us to be something we are not. So instead of that, we break free from the constraints of the ego. We understand who we are, whose we are, and then what brings fulfillment. So what brings ultimate fulfillment is not gaining a bigger part, but playing our part better. If we don't have to necessarily do something wonderful to be successful, if we just do something worthwhile, that can also bring fulfillment in our lives. And in that way, sometimes we will have a bigger role to play. Sometimes we may have a smaller role to play. But whatever our role is, the size of the role won't determine our satisfaction. It is how much are we putting our heart and contributing. So self-acceptance requires self-worth, and self-worth comes by not comparing ourselves with others, but by comparing ourselves with our capacity. And that becomes easier when we understand that we are souls and we are all loved by Krishna, irrespective of whatever be the particular position in our life and the contribution we are making according to that position. So thank you very much. Hare Krishna.